At some point, I'm sure that you've come across a video on YouTube somewhere of a musician playing something after only hearing it once. And of course, these videos are always meant to show like, oh my God, that's so amazing. How could somebody learn something instantly after only hearing it one time? So one of the very first things that's important to understand about this concept is that while theory, music theory, is absolutely applied, it is not a prerequisite to be able to do this. And that's because the key to this skill is something kind of completely different from understanding theory. It can definitely help, but there's something that's far more important, and that is having a developed ear. Now, what do we mean when we say having a developed ear? There's so much in music that we can essentially learn from a book. Now, I said that music theory is not a prerequisite to being able to do this. And the reason that that is an important distinction is because there's a huge difference between learning it from the book and developing your ear. Learning from the book is kind of like, okay, learn the definitions to pass the test, but developing your ear requires years and years of immersion and exposure to the music that you want to play and sound like, so that there are things about that music that you just inherently understand because you've heard them so many times before. For jazz musicians, this is probably a 2-5-1, or even perhaps like a 1-4-3-6-2-5-1. That's a bunch of numbers. Here's what it sounds like. It's one of those things that we could hear in music and be like, oh yeah, I know where this is going. Why? Because we've developed our ear over a long period of time and we've had exposure and immersion to many of the things that sound like that. See, this is why music theory is not necessarily a prerequisite to being able to hear something once and immediately play it back. It's less about the definitions. So in other words, it's less about the fact that that was a 1-4-3-6-2-5-1 and much more about simply the sound of it. I could have learned to play that without actually learning what any of it was called. This immersion and exposure over a long period of time is what helps us really understand music as a language, just the same way as you would learn to understand any other spoken language. I took 5 years of Spanish in school. I don't know Spanish. But if I had gone to live in a Spanish-speaking country for even 1 year, I'd probably learn far, far more. That's the power of exposure and immersion, and that is what's going on here that allows musicians to do this. We're basically listening and going, oh yeah, 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 no, I understand where they're going with this. Why? Because we've heard it so many times before. What are today's top Spotify hits? Let's see. Ghost by Justin Bieber is number 2. Ghost, Justin Bieber. Let's find Ghost, Justin Bieber, and let's listen to a little bit of this. So what I'm gonna do here, as it's going, I'm gonna try to essentially learn this as quickly as I possibly can, and then I'm gonna explain a little bit about how I'm doing it. Just a reminder, everything on the Academy is 30% off. Use code MUSICTHEORY30. There's a link down in the description below. Okay, let's go. Wow, this is really sad. Young blood thinks there's always tomorrow. I miss your touch on nights when I'm hollow. I know you crossed the bridge that I can't follow. Since the love that you left is all that I get, I want you to. There's always tomorrow. I need more time, but time can't be borrowed. I'd leave it all behind if I could follow. Since the love that you left is all that I get, I want you to know.
There we go.
I mean, that's kind of it. I'm sure there's a bridge. Let's see if there's a bridge. Maybe there's not. I don't know, but let's...
Settle for the ghost of you. I miss you more than life. And if you can't be next to me, your memory is ecstasy. I miss you more than life. I miss you more than life.
It's gonna end there. Okay. I've never heard that. I didn't know that that was even a song. I just Googled Spotify top charts and that was number two. So I was like, okay, what is this? And basically it's two parts. I mean, you have this classic, highly used pop chord progression because it's really nice, right? It's this nice development. It kind of has a minor question and then a major response in a sense. Like this starts minor, but then it's like kind of almost asking a question, and then there's, we have an answer, there's a resolution, and then it's gonna come around again back there, right? And so the only other part to that song that's it. So we have this E minor, F sharp minor 7, or probably F sharp minor 7. It could also be like a D over F sharp to the G, and then G, B minor, A. That's it. That's the entire song. As I started to hear that in the introduction, I immediately was like, okay, I know it's gonna use this chord progression a lot, but then you might have noticed partway through when we got to that part where I was like, okay, I'm expecting them to set up the chorus now. There's gonna be some type of like pre-hook type of thing, right? So I kind of stopped and I was like listening, and that's when I heard this. That part. That's when I heard that part, and so I said, okay, now I know that that's where that is. And then the only other real thing I had to listen to was, does the chorus just stick to that same 6-4-1-5 chord progression, and is there a bridge? Those are the questions that are kind of kicking around in my head, and I'm kind of just like, okay, well, are there any things in this form that are going to subvert expectations, or is it pretty much just going to be, yep, it's just the tune, it's just this section, and then this other little thing, and that's pretty much it. So obviously with this type of super mainstream pop music from somebody like Justin Bieber, it tends to be a lot easier because Justin's goal is not to create the most like harmonically complex music, it's just to more so tell stories and create like a nice palette of sound with satisfying chord progressions. This is a great example of that. It's exactly what your ear is expecting and it satisfies that expectation without offering anything that throws your ear for a loop or that, you know, makes you kind of go, oh, whoa, that was weird. And oftentimes in like jazz jam sessions, this is a common skill that you'll use because if you want to play and you're up there and somebody calls a tune that you don't know, you have two options. You can either get off the bandstand because you don't know the tune, or you can just say, well, I'll figure it out. As we mentioned before, with some of those classic jazz chord progressions, what we're essentially listening for are any clues that will tell us this is probably roughly where we're gonna go with this. We hear things that have just been used time and time again, and those are the things that make us go, oh yeah, yeah, no, I get it. I understand what you're doing here. And when a musician listens to something one time having never heard it before, that's mostly what they're gonna be listening for, are those context clues within the harmony and within the structure. And again, these things don't require music theory knowledge to understand. They just require exposure and experience. And that long-term immersion that will have placed those commonalities and those things that we see time and time again into your ear so that you can pull them out and say, I understand where they're going with this and I can just play along because I've done it before. I already know what this is gonna be. And it doesn't say anything inherent about the music in question. It's not like the music in question is bad because it's predictable. Sometimes predictable is what you want, but it really does make it an absolutely applicable skill set to be able to listen to these things and understand, okay, I get what this is doing. So when you see musicians that hear something for the very first time and immediately turn around and play it, I know there's gonna be a zoom there. I just know that there was a zoom there, wasn't there? That's what they're doing. They're utilizing their experience and their exposure to the language of music to make assumptions about what's coming next. The way to practice this skill set is quite simply just to consume large amounts of music over a long period of time and learn how they all go on your instrument. Work out these chord progressions and learn a lot of the common chord progressions that are used in your favorite genre. Before long, you'll start start to recognize, oh yeah, this thing sounds like this other thing. And when you start making those connections, that's when you can really start understanding how to just hear something and just kind of know where it's going. Immersion and exposure is the most valuable tool in music that we have. It will subconsciously teach you a ton. Thank you for checking out this video. We will see you in the next one.